right, so real quick before we get to Frank, on 6-11, or did you mean 11-6?
Sorry,
11-6. 11-6. Gator Ford, fishing conversation with Captain Mike. Captain Jeff Page is going to be there. If you guys have never seen Captain Jeff Page speak, you ought to go to it because he's shot out of a cannon. Wide open. It was full blast, but he's full of knowledge. On the 5th and 6th of November, we have the Ruskin Seafood Festival. We'll have a booth that's going to be, are they doing it at the fairgrounds or at the at Simmons Park, or where are they doing
Simmons.
Simmons again? We'll be out at Simmons Park. Then on November 3rd, here at our club meeting, we have Captain Scott Moore going to come speak. And then 4-1, you want to talk about this 4-1-2017?
Go ahead,
man. Kids Fishing Tournament, SSA, Gallify Marine, Hillsborough County. I don't know any details. That'd be all you.
After I got
you.
What we're putting in with the Parks Department, we're going to sponsor, we're co-sponsor with the club here and Alify. We're going to do a free kids fishing tournament on April Fool's Day of next year out of E.G. Simmons Park. Details are going to come out as we get closer to it. But, you know, we'll be looking for sponsors and donations. Going to be putting in for a grant to help fund some stuff to give to the kids and whatnot. It'll be from pretty much age 3 to 15. And we're going to basically open up Simmons Park anywhere that you could wet a line. And that's, we're going to need the club, the volunteers from the club, to basically station themselves around all the areas where we could fish, because it's going to be catch. The kids are going to record it, let it go. If they want to take it home, it's a keeper, they can do that. But we're not sure if we'll probably do some awards for the most fish, biggest fish. We may do some species. Just a fun morning, starting around 9 a.m. We're going to have lunch for everybody. Wrap up by 2 o'clock and hopefully have a captain or two come out, do a seminar out of the pavilion towards the
and
end of the day.
It's free for all kids, right?
It's going to be free for all kids. The only thing that's I know that's going to have a cost is entering the park. So it'll be $2 for up to 8 people in your vehicle. So $2 to get into the park, and then everything else, you know, we're going to do some pre-registration on the website, and we won't turn anybody away if they show up the day of. But it's just going to be a free event. There was a request that there was not enough kids fishing, like the redfish tournament, so
right.
People start talking about it. And of course, since I do what I do, they asked me to jump in, and I said, sure, I'll get involved again. And we're going to...
Well, let's be honest, Dad's involved. You really ain't got to do much.
Yeah, well, you work for the county, I'll be the county link. You know what I'm saying?
You'll be the liaison?
Yeah, we'll get all that set up. But something new, something different. It's going to be strictly for kids. Parents, you're not fishing that day. You're going to help kids fish and help record and just enjoy the day with your child if you bring them and you're out there. But more details to come as we get closer.
So we're only fishing from the bank, not from a boat?
Yep, all bank fishing.
All bank?
Yep, and there's probably, since I do camps at that park, there's a good 6 or 7 spots that groups can fish, and then if they go to the other side, there's some individual cuts in the mangroves. People will fill in those spots. It'll just be
biggest
fun.
Catfish category for sure.
Oh,
absolutely.
Well, I'm telling you, it's got, you know, this summer at camp we caught a lot of trout, a lot of flounder out there. Flounder too.
We filleted snook out of there.
Yeah. Oh yeah, we caught snook and whatnot. We even got a small Goliath grouper.
Yeah.
Out of the hey, they're there.
Face like bald eagle.
You got lucky on that one. But it'll just be a fun event. It'll be good, you know, good for the kids in the area. If anything, we're going to encourage families that maybe don't take their kids' mission to come on out that day. Let them try something new. Everything works out right. Excuse me for a second. I'll have rods and reels for all the kids. And if I get that grant, they'll go home with one. So,
okay.
Yeah, that's what we're working on here.
Awesome. Greatly appreciated.
No problem.
So without any further ado, I wanted to change it up a little bit because duck season starts next month for us. Starts always, you have the May season, it is the Saturday before Thanksgiving, it runs until the Sunday after Thanksgiving, then we have a couple weeks off. I think this year starts on, what, the 10th of December?
10th
of December.
Opening day for November season is 19th.
Yep.
It's a Saturday.
Saturday's always the Saturday before Thanksgiving until the Sunday after Thanksgiving.
Yep.
And then December 10th until the last Sunday in January will be the season. And a lot of people like to fish. I've known Frank now for about 5 years. I've fished against him in a bunch of redfish tournaments. He's an awesome captain. He's always at the top five in any of the tournaments we do. When it comes to wintertime fishing, absolutely phenomenal. I've had the pleasure last year of really duck hunting with him. Know his dad real well. We actually do a lot of deer hunting up in Alabama with him. So it's become really, really close to me. But now that we're starting to swing into, a lot of us like the duck hunt. You guys hear me talking about it all the time. A lot of you guys might want to try to get into it. A lot of you guys I know, I've seen there seeing you guys fishing while I'm duck hunting. Maybe I'll give you a shot over the head or not. Maybe questionable. It all depends on how close you got to the decoys. But I wanted to bring Frank because he is an excellent fisherman and he's an excellent duck hunter. So without any further ado, Captain Frank Leto.
Appreciate it.
Junior. You want to talk about fishing first?
I don't care what we do. I was going to talk about me, but that's all right. So I want to tell a little bit about myself. Pretty young looking guy standing up here in front of this crowd. I actually do have about 25 years experience duck hunting. I killed my first bird when I was 10 years old. I actually killed it on the property the Bass Pro Shops is built on. We grew up hunting rabbits here in Tampa, Brandon, Riverview, Ruskin, Gibsonton, and we used to do a lot of jump shooting when I was a kid. My father was a diehard bird hunter, raised bird dogs from the time he was a kid. Grandfather raised dogs. Great grandfather raised dogs. Rabbits, quail.
Rabbits.
Yeah. Killed, I mean, filled this room to the top with cottontails and swamp rabbits from the area that we're in right now. Rattlesnakes bigger than most of us standing here. So with that, I killed my first bird, like I said, when I was 10, and I was hooked. It was over after that. All I wanted to do was shoot stuff that was flying. I thought it was cool. Trying to figure out how to get out in front of birds, and you know, birds that cut and dip, and you can't ever replicate that when you go to the clays. I suggest everybody going to shoot clays before you go duck hunting. You think you're going to be dead on them every time you go shoot, you know, 25 out of 25 shooting clays, but Tiger can attest to it that once that pattern gets formed and those teal dip in on the decoys and they start doing backflips and somersaults and getting sideways, it changes things. But
it's one of the biggest things that I tell people that one of their first times duck hunting that we've had out there with us. Oh, I can shoot clays all night. Good for you. But when you're shooting clays, you got to remember you're using lead, and you're using probably about a million of those small little BBs.
Make it look like a rock star.
Yeah, when you sit there and shoot ducks, you have to use steel. They're twice as heavy, they sink, and you don't have that many in there. Especially if you're shooting these ducks out here in your bed. So when you're sitting there used to going, all right, I'm aiming right at that decoy, or I'm ready at the clay, I'm right on it. When you're doing it with a duck, you've got to be at least 2 feet in front of him and about a foot above him.
Yep.
And be on the money, because they have feathers that are like Kevlar.
Some of these divers we get out on the bay, I mean, they're dropping in 35, 45 miles an hour. Sometimes they look like they're going 80. The teal sound like they're going 80, but you can be anywhere from 2 feet to 6 feet out in front of them, depending on how they're coming in. But back to the fishing stuff and what Tiger was talking about. I fish a lot of tournaments. I fished the local Flats Masters here when it was in Tampa. We won Team of the Year for Tampa Bay and Charlotte Harbor within the same year a few years back, which landed me a sponsorship with Young Boats. Young's out of Crystal River, and they've been building me tournament boats for the past 4 years now. Been through 5 boats with them, sold 12 for the company. Fished, like I said, the Flats Masters, the Flats Masters Elite here in Tampa, the IFA, the Lucas Oil tournaments. We were runner-up for Team of the Year, Lucas Oil, last year. We fished Charlotte Harbor, took third, went down to home Louisiana for the first time, placing the top 10 out of 150 Louisianians, or whatever you want to call them. So as far as hunting and fishing is concerned, I was brought up on it. It's what I do. It's who I am. But to start, we're in the South Shore Anglers Club. We'll talk about fishing first. Wintertime fishing. Who in here likes to wade fish? Okay, good. We got a bunch of wade fish. But I think it's critical in the wintertime. Unless you've got a technical poling skiff and your boat can float in 5, 6, 7 inches of water, getting out of the boat, stalking fish, getting out of the boat, pulling up on fish, and then getting out of the boat and stalking up on fish is something that we do regularly. We do it after we duck hunt, probably 2 or 3 days of the week during the season. What kind of baits, gentlemen that raise their hands, what kind of baits do you throw in the wintertime? What kind of presentation?
Soft plastics.
All soft plastics?
All soft plastics.
What size leader do you like to tie on?
20 pound, usually use a 16th ounce or eighth ounce jig head.
Okay. What kind of soft plastics you throw?
Sometimes I'll use Gulp, sometimes I use DOAs. It doesn't matter.
As far as like the sizes of your baits, do you find any differences in the wintertime, the patterns that you throw in the wintertime versus the spring or fall as far as your soft plastics are concerned?
Smaller.
Yeah. Everybody's saying smaller.
I typically go with like a 3 or 4 inch.
I don't
fish a whole lot of artificials in the spring and fall.
Gotcha. Who said smaller? You said smaller. What do you throw? How far down do you dial it down?
I use like a 14-pound.
14-pound leader?
10-pound line.
Yep.
And it's 16-ounce jig head.
Yep.
And I'll throw usually like those Riptide mullets.
Okay.
So they're like
3-inch bait.
Yeah.
Yeah. I dial it way back in the wintertime. I do use a 3 or 4 inch paddle tail bait. I work it extremely slow. How many people bass fishing here? Everybody seems to cut their teeth on bass fishing, bluegill fishing. All right, so anybody in here drug a culprit worm, whether it be a moccasin worm or a red shad worm, bullet head weight, peg to the head, that's pretty much the style that I'm fishing, not the worm, but the style that I'm fishing in the wintertime. Mm-hmm. As slow as I can get it to where you're almost damn bored with it. Dragging it across the bottom, especially on these ice cold mornings where we'd love to duck hunt with the winds cranking, we'll find a protected shoreline. Fish smaller baits. Past 2 years, we've won almost $10,000 on the bait that's put out by Z-Man. And some people look at me like my tournament partner, like, man, quit telling people about this bait. But in the line of work that we're in, I mean, we want people to catch fish. And I've been repping for Z-Man for 5 years now. Tiger's been with it for quite some time. They want us to sell baits. Say, Joey Prochazka is the guy that helps us out quite a bit getting his products out. And he told me personally and another Z-Man rep, Josh Bibler's out of Sarasota. There's 5 of us in there, or 6 of us. Shallow Tails, you, me, CA, Bibler. I think they're
Grand Up.
6 or 7. There's a few of us. They said that the pro staffers are what's driving their sales in the field. Guys that are getting out there and talking about their baits. Whenever we go to these expos, we sit there and talk about the baits that are on display. We try to push your products that we're catching the fish on. You'll have a lot of guys stand up and give you a generalization of a bait. You need to throw a mullet-sized bait. You need to reel it this way on this kind of jig head. I try to be as particular as I can. So without further ado, we'll talk about the Crusties by Z-Man. It's C-R-U-S-T-A-Z. It is a sand flea-looking crab. It's about 2.5 inches long. Now, 16-ounce jig head's great. If you've got the tackle to throw it with, you have the right rod, you have the right line, you have the right reel. I go heavier because I like to throw further in the wintertime. I want to be able to cast as far as I possibly can. 10-pound braid with a 12-pound leader is what I throw. 3 to 4 feet of leader line is what I put on it. A lot of guys say it doesn't matter. It may not. It may just be me. But I drag that real small bait on a weedless hook. Edge jig heads. It was made by Joe Hebert. He's also local. I'm not exactly sure. Do you know, Tiger, where Joe's out of?
Can't remember.
Well, the edge jig head comes in many different sizes, 16s, 3/8s, quarter, I think a 5/8s. They have some funny off sizes. A root beer color, a darker color to match that Crusty's crab. I like throwing the pumpkin or the gudgeon is another color. It's a darker, sandy, brown kind of color. I can't really describe the color. You guys can pull out your smartphones and look up Crusty's gudgeon, look up Crusty's.
You said it was a weedless jig head?
You can throw the edge weedless, or especially in the wintertime, a lot of the fish will get on sand. You'll see the fish staging on sand trying to sunbathe, trying to get warm. In that scenario, I won't throw weedless, but the edge jig head fits that Crusty's crab. It's the shortest shank, heaviest jig head that I could find that would fit it, that has a hook strong enough to hold up to it. Z-Man sells a whole bunch of a smaller jig heads with their finesse style fishing, and they're great if you play your drags. Loosen those drags up as long as you're fishing an area where the fish can't get into cover and break you off. I fish a super light drag throwing this stuff. Another successful bait, which sounds crazy, and I wish I had a photo book to show you guys, but anybody ever throw worms, saltwater fishing? Green worms, trick worms, stuff that you throw like Gary Yamamoto's for bass.
I throw those ones that are for the stripers.
Like a shaky head style worm, it's a floating
it's like
worm?
They're ridged.
Okay. So there's a lot of different companies that produce a worm. Like I said, him and I are partial to Z-Man. I throw the Zinkers by Z-Man, but Yum, I can't remember the name of the actual bait. Yum makes a trick worm, it's a floating worm. Gary Yamamoto makes one. I believe even gulp has a floating worm. The style of fishing kind of came from bass fishing. It's shaky head jigging. Guys use it for spot fishing ledges up in the reservoirs up in Alabama, Georgia, Kentucky Lake, all those lakes up there. I found that growing up here on a lake in Florida, also was blessed with my parents, had a nice enough house to have a swimming pool in the backyard. I grab a new bait, throw it in the swimming pool, see how it worked, and go out to the lake and try it, and that's how I figure out how my fish work. My baits worked on fish. So that shaky head style worm, same presentation, long casting, dragging really slow, cold winter days. That worm, basically, when you use a shaky head style jig, like I said, use your smartphone, look it up. The jig is designed to stand straight up and down on top of its head. The lead being up down at the bottom, the hook standing straight up. When you put that floating worm on it, it allows that worm to stand straight up and down on the water column. When you drag it, that worm barely break the plane of going back to horizontal, and it'll pop right back up. I had a redfish that we filleted a couple weeks ago, and I guess the pattern's already starting a little bit early. Had four green grass worms. I don't know if y'all ever seen them out in the wild out here in the bay, but we have worms that live on the flats. They're green. I'm talking like mallard head green worms. And they're anywhere from 6 inches to 12 inches long. They live in mud. If you find redfish tailing in mud, outgoing tides, just try that worm. It is a deadly, deadly deal. People think, you know, like a bass, they'll suck down a worm and they'll be swimming with a worm hanging out of their mouth. Redfish are predators that feed and they use their crushers. When they suck that worm out, it looks like a piece of spaghetti. I've watched it go down their throat. Dragging it past them, you'll see that entire 6 to 8 inch long worm just slurp right down his throat. So don't do the typical bass thing. When they eat a worm, they're like, oh crap, I gotta reel that, stick him. Usually they just swallow a whole. Top waters, who likes to know top waters?
What color worm, green? What's the color?
I like green.
Which one?
Well, there's a bunch of different ones out there.
I know they have like the slammer.
Slammers? Yeah, I don't particularly use the slammers. I know people that do. Z-Man makes one called the Zinkers. It's a Z-I-N-K-E-R-Z. The color that I use is sprayed grass. And it is like a June bug kind of color. It's that kind of Christmas dark green, purple, green, and silver glitter in it. A green pumpkin worm works great. I don't know if it's brown pumpkin, but that tannish color pumpkin with the black flake in it works great. Anything that imitates that grass worm. So you want a dark earth tone style color is what you're looking for.
With this shaky head?
Shaky head jig. There's
Or not like one of those drop shots.
I don't use the drop shots or the articulus. The articulus jig heads are the ones that have a lima bean style head. It's attached to a split ring. It's attached to a twist lock style hook. Everybody familiar with twist locks? I've got a coil spring on the head and a big wide gap worm hook. Those will work. I don't personally use them. I like the shaky head style. Z-Man sells them. And shaky head is actually a brand name. They sell them too. They're out of Alabama. I believe it's Seal, Alabama. Net Result is a company that's up there too, and they sell a great worm. They have a key lime pie colored worm that I've used before. Chartreuse belly with a dark green back. Works awesome. Garlic flavored. I like scent in the wintertime. Anybody use scents? Anybody use Procure? Yeah, big fan. I'm a big fan. I mean, I've caught Tiger, I don't know, he can attest to it. Hundreds of fish just dead sticking with tons of Procure. Sometimes those fish won't even want a bait that's moving in the wintertime.
What scent do you use with Procure?
Well, it depends on what I'm using.
And where you're at.
And where I'm at.
Two different things. Because usually they have like a mullet scent and they have a shrimp scent. Mm-hmm. Right? Depends on where you're at. Like down here, mullet works really well for your larger redfish. The shrimp smell is going to sit there and be for your like pups and some of the ones like in the mangroves. Now, if you guys look like on those Z-Man baits, you'll notice on one side of that Z-Man bait, there's a slice all the way through it. Slice this all the way through it and slap fill that thing full of that pure Procure and just throw it out there and just let it sit.
I'm talking, I fill that gap he's talking about. I cover my hook. I cover the outside of the bait. It looks silly by the time I throw it in the water, but 10 casts later, you still have scent on it versus just throwing a stripe on it and it comes off after a couple of casts. Back to what Tiger was touching on and to your question, the scents that I like to use are dependent upon what I'm fishing. If my scenario is fish tailing and they're eating shrimp and they're eating crabs and snails, starfish I've seen in their bellies, any kind of crustacean, I use a crustacean scent. They sell oils as well as sauces. If you want to prep up your bags the night before, you can get a thing of crab oil. squirt, I'm talking the smallest amount, like a quarter of a teaspoon, half teaspoon of that oil, drop it in there, stir it up and inside the bag, seal it, and just let it sit until tomorrow. That stuff saturates that bait, it gets down to the pores of the bait, and you'll have scent on your bait for hours. Touch it up with the sauce or touch it up with the Pro-Cure gel. Once it starts, you know, starting to lose that slime or that slip to it whenever you grab your bait. And if you're in an area, like I said, we had the crustacean scenario. You're in an area, there's a lot of krill, small bait fish, a lot of fry, finger mullet, those little silver mullet you see in the wintertime, killifish, maharas. I'll throw either the saltwater blend, which is all the bait fish just ground up together. I'll throw a menhaden. I'll put a menhaden or a saltwater blend or the mullet on my baits, depending upon the pattern that I'm throwing. Topwater fisherman, everybody loves topwater. What's your topwater?
So what do you do with your self-bait when it's now you're done with it? It's not nothing biting it. You got Pro-Cure all over it. You can't put it back in your.
Put it in a Ziploc bag.
Yeah, don't Ziploc.
Put it in a Ziploc bag.
That's what people normally do.
Dude, you gotta remember, the Z-Man bait.
They're impregnated with it.
You cannot destroy those things. The only thing that can sit there and eat that thing is a pufferfish. Mm-hmm. That's it. You can sit there and stretch them as far as you want to, you're not gonna break them.
Now, I will tell you that you can't mix whatever they put in that Z-Man to make it do what it does. You cannot mix that into another bag. You can't grab your Z-Man minnow and throw it in a bag of DOA cows and expect the next trip out to not have one big blob of jelly in that bag. I don't know what's in those Z-Mans, but it will bind and melt every bait in your bag. You can only put Z-Mans in Z-Mans. So to answer your question, when you're done with that bait, you want to switch baits, take that one off, throw it back in a bag of Z-Mans if you're throwing Z-Mans, and it will be fine. As far as leaving them in there and letting that scent stay in the bag, I use the same bag of baits after I've saturated them a couple of trips, and then I just order another bag. So topwater man, what's your topwater choice?
Super Spook Junior usually.
Millions of fish caught. Yep, millions and millions. That's mine too. I like that one. I also like the Rapala Skitter Walk. All bone. I nicknamed him Mike a long time ago. People asked me what I was catching fish on and say, Mike, don't look at me funny, just keep on walking. I don't want to tell them what I was throwing. That bone white spook.
Yep.
It's a fish killing machine, and in the wintertime, what's your presentation? You walk the dog, you run the dog, you walk the dog nice and slow.
Yeah, a lot slower than they do in the summertime.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I found that working topwater baits in the wintertime can be slow and tedious, especially in plastics when you're dragging them slow, but the strikes is unbelievable. Walk that dog really slow. When you pause, I allow the rings to completely dissipate from around my bait. Mm-hmm. And sometimes after I allow that to happen, I'll just twitch that bait once or twice to allow it to slash. And then let the same thing happen all over again, let all the rings dissipate. I can't tell you how many times just that bait sitting there all by itself, covered in the scent, like Pro-Cure, that fish is just sitting under it waiting, seeing what it's gonna do next. And even that one twitch or two twitches will allow that fish to blow up all over that bait.
Is the water calm during that time, or are you talking like,
what are you talking about, sir?
Like when you do the top water, the water comes.
Well, I mean, situation dictates. I mean, I'll fish top water on a breezy day. I like throwing top waters on breezy days where I don't have too much surface slap, especially overcast days. If I'm working schools of mullet, I can throw, if that's my target is fishing mullet schools that day, I'll keep a top water on my rod all day long. Every once in a while, you'll see a fish just single out that one sick mullet, that one small mullet, that one injured mullet, and blow him sideways out of the water. We had fish tailing in front of us the other day. I put a video up on Facebook, and these fish were in a crustacean feeding zone. I mean, they were just standing on their heads. We watched them for 30 minutes. Out of nowhere, you see one fish explode, and I've never seen a pinfish jump in my life, but one about the size of my hand skipped across top of the water like a penny sideways, about four times away from that thing. So keeping the top water tight on all the time, I think, is a great idea if you're going to be throwing artifice. See what we had my bird hunting stuff up front. We go down to my fishing stuff. We talked about dialing down leader size, dialing down bait size. Other baits that I love in the wintertime, I found tons of success on. We talked about the Z-Man, we talked about the worm, we talked a little bit about throwing top waters. I throw plugs as well in the wintertime. Now, don't necessarily have to always throw a plug and rip it fast. There's rice all in this thing. That's a tit. I don't know if any of y'all have seen before, but if they're rice in with your saltwater plugs, it draws all the salts up into the rice and keeps it off your hooks if you're switching plugs back and forth all day. Tiger heard me talk about them. He's seen the picture of the fish I caught on. Unfair Lures is one of my sponsors for my team. I just started fishing them a couple years back. These things are, the name of the company is perfect. It's Unfair throwing these things. The patterns that I find work great in the wintertime are the perch, which is actually a freshwater plug that a lot of guys are throwing it up north, and the pinfish. There's also another one that I don't think I have in here. It's called a green pumpkin shad, and it looks almost like a bluegill with an orange belly. I don't know why they like it, but they seem to love it. These baits are very buoyant. They work in that 0 to 2 feet water column, so they're great for shallow water fishing, especially areas there's not a lot of grass, don't over sand, don't over potholes, don't have a lot of floating debris. The bait, just reeling this bait, I call it a dummy bait. You can cast it out and just reel it back. You don't have to do anything to it. It's got a swivel on the head. The hydrodynamics of the bait allow it to swim just like a pinfish, just straight reeling it back in the boat. Rod tip to the water like you're ripping a spoon and just reel it back. Now, they have a couple different, like every plug company, they got all different sizes and all different types of actions on the plugs. They have one called a rip and slash. I use the rip and slash action on this arrowhead. This is the one that I'm holding up in my hand that I said perch or pinfish is awesome. This is the arrowhead plug. When you apply action to this thing, it will turn completely sideways and throw that flash at you. When you're going across the flash, you see the pinfish just turn sideways and give you that little bit of flash when they're down in the grass. If you switch this plug, it will completely flip this plug sideways and correct itself. So it will throw a huge flash. The rip and slash baits that I throw in the wintertime are small. Most of your white bait you're going to find on the flats, if you find any, are going to be small. Fishing channels, you can move it up to a larger rip or a larger plug like a mirror lure or mirror dean. Same action, reel it slow, swims just like a bait, rip it and slash it like the name suggests, and it throws off an awesome shine. Unfair Lures. Unfair Lures, they're out of actual Crystal River right by Young Boats, and they've really taken the field by storm in Texas and Louisiana. Trout fishermen are in love with these things. If y'all want to kill some trout in the wintertime, try them out. That, and like I said, the Miradines, I've got a few of them in here that barely have any shine left to them. They got teeth marks all in them. I use the smallest Miradine. Tiger, you may be able to know the name, size. I don't know the name for size. I just grabbed the smallest one that I could find. I can pass this around and show y'all, but there ain't much left shine to this thing. There's thousands of teeth marks in it.
They have one that's a
mirror
glass.
I've seen that one as well, and I actually had my buddy take me to school with that thing this year. I was throwing the mirror deans, and I actually have a box of them. I just didn't bring it. This was just in my blind bag. That mirror glass minnow or whatever it's called.
Yeah, it's tiny.
It's tiny, and my buddy was catching pigs on it. We went way back up in the creeks in Largo, and he was throwing that thing on like 15-pound test on a really light rod, fishing 6 feet of water, was catching 36 to 40 inch snook on it, and it's a bait this big. Elephants eat peanuts. You don't always need the biggest bait to catch the biggest fish. That thing's awesome. If anybody hadn't tried it, try it. It's a great bait. I touched on spoons when I was talking about retrieving these unfair lures. Bar none, the most redfish catching device that ever hit the fishing world. The spoon is one of the three baits that I will absolutely not take off my rod tournament fishing. You can cover a ton of ground. If you're fishing an area that you want to go sight fishing, rip a spoon the whole time, keep your trolling motor on. I don't know what kind of trolling motors you guys have, but your load setting, your 1 or 2 or 2.5, just cruise and rip this spoon. You will find more fish with this thing than you will with these things right here.
What color? Are you saying troll it while you're...
Oh, no. Just drop your trolling motor. Do you have an iPilot?
Yeah.
Even if you don't have an iPod, just throw that stick between your legs and keep bumping it with your knee. Fire the spoon and fan cast it. Cover 22 points above the beam where your lights are shining on your boat. Cover that pie-shaped wedge off the front of your boat. Just keep ripping it. Keep your rod tip down, and don't be afraid, even in the wintertime, to burn this thing. It's a reaction strike. This thing goes past the fish's face. All he's seen is flash and something hauling ass away from him. It's innate in their structure to want to chase and slam this thing. I will slow roll them on the super cold days, which we have about 5 days of the year that are like that. But for the most part, I keep a medium retrieve. If I see a fish charge up behind this thing, I'm trying to get it away from him. As fast as I could possibly grab that spoon is what I'm going to do. that will trigger that fish to strike this thing 9 times out of 10.
Are you using a split ring or a swivel on the front of that?
This is an aqua dream. Aqua dreams come with a split ring on them. If you fish any other brand out there, you can add the split ring, you can add a swivel. I like to have the split rings. I'm not saying that swivels are the end all be all as far as, you know, throwing spoons and ripping spoons. A lot of people like doing it. I don't think it's necessary. I do think that snap ring that's on the front of it allows it to have a little bit more play. And I will rig it with a real small loop knot. I think that kind of takes over the need for that swivel. As far as colors go, I'm a big fan of gold. I'm a really big fan of copper. You don't hear a lot of people throwing copper spoons. Maybe you do, but copper is kind of a good go-between that silver and that gold. If you have that water color that's, you know, not quite crystal clear, it's got a little bit of a stain to it. I prefer copper over a white spoon. You see a lot of people throwing the white as well. I like that white when there's a lot of white bait. And like right now, the flats are flooded with white bait. That white spoon works excellent ripping those white bait schools. As well as flats that are loaded with pinfish, I've used white and silver. If you spend any time on the flats and you're trolling or doing an area that's got thousands and thousands of pinfish, you'll just see them roll and shine in the grass. It almost looks like white bait if there's enough of them. And that spoon, it's just one of those baits that matches the hatch, if you will. Whenever they see that flash, they can't stop. They've got to eat it. What else we got on fishing? Talk about baits, transitioning fish on big tides. How many times you guys been out on a flat, everything looked good to you? There's bait moving, it's glass calm, and you're just like, where in the hell are the fish? Everything's right. I mean, it's calm out here, we got good tide moving, fish are pushing out. You look way out on the flat and you see that lone mullet school that looks like it's 700 yards away from you. Anybody in this room have that equation happen to them?
All the time.
Okay. So, fish have different transition zones, just like deer, just like ducks, just like anything that you hunt. They're going to go to where their happy place is. And if you're not in an area, what I call shaken, you may see some bait schools, and you think everything looks right, but you're not seeing the game fish that should be eating these things, or at least staging around these things. Get away from it. Use that trolling motor and run it until your batteries are getting low. We'll go out and pre-fish for a tournament. We'll put the trolling motor in the water at first light, and when the trolling motor dies, your day's done. That's how long we'll stay on the trolling motor just in hunt for fish. I mean, hours. Sometimes I'll go 3 or 4 hours without a bite. I'll cover miles of shoreline without a single bite. But once you find where they want to be, their happy place, that's what you're looking for. You're looking for the fish that are staging around the bait. We talked about that lone mullet school that transitions way out. We're in an area where you have vast flats. I mean, just miles and miles and miles of flats. And you have the drop-off. I call the drop-off or the outside shoal the reef for the flat. The fish in Tampa Bay don't get to the weights of the fish in Louisiana and Texas and Mississippi and Alabama because they transition so far and so much. They eat. You'll go have days where you'll catch 50, 60 fish sitting in a hole, but those fish aren't going to gain the size and the weight as our fish in Louisiana because the fish don't have to transition so far. So I've been on fish on high tide where I'll be fishing the mangrove line, and their transition zone at low tide, call it a 3 foot high tide where they're crammed in the mangroves, to a 0.0 low tide. Sometimes those same fish that I'm fishing in the bushes will go 1,000 yards across a flat. 1,000 yards sounds crazy, but it's true. We'll figure out these transition zones by following those reefs, like I said, the outside shoal. You've got some down here at Cockroach Bay, you've got them down in Joe's Bay. On that negative low tide, drop a trolling motor and just start following a shoal, the outside edge of that flat, and follow it until you get bored of following it, and then follow it some more. You will find an area where the fish are going to transition to, whether it's a point, whether it's a pass in the bar, a break in the bar, where there's a belly inside of the bar. There's going to be an area where the bait fish are dumping to, the mullet are dumping to, and the fish are going to be dumping to. If you find that zone, then you can follow those fish on the incoming tide and find out where they're going on high tide. So you find these fish at 0.0, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. water's gonna rip back into, let's say, a 2.5 by 5 o'clock. That's 5 hours and 2.5 feet. That's a lot of moving water really quick. Watch where your mullet go. Stay on those mullet if you're in fish. Let's say you're catching them or not catching them. Those fish may not eat just because they transition way out there with all the bait fish. That might not be their happy place to eat. That might just be their transition zone. Watch where your bait goes on the incoming tide. Follow that mullet school all the way back down that creek. Follow it back down that shoal. Follow it up inside the basin and see where the mullet like to loll, is what I call it. Where they're happy, where they're rolling on top of each other, not making high, long, bounding jumps where they're traveling like greyhounds, but making those lazy flip-flop rolls. And you will find where their happy place is. And that's what it's all about. Whether it is deer, whether it's ducks, whether it's fish, being where they want to be is the key. And in doing that, you've got to spend just countless hours on your trolling motor and on the water burning gas.
How many of you guys fish live bait during the winter? Shrimp?
Shrimp.
How do you fish it though? Put a weight on it, put like a little split shot on it, you fish it with a popping cork?
Well, 1 ounce weight, both. 4 liter.
What's that?
Ready rig?
Who's a
love lure fisherman? Someone raise your hand here. Anybody fish love lures? Thank you. How many people are here to talk about duck hunting or want to hear about some duck hunting? I know one. I got one. Justin's leaving. He's so tired of this. I like throwing big mullet and chunks.
Huh?
He likes throwing big mullet and chunks.
Catch a big fish.
That's right.
Yeah. You don't have to get your hip replaced.
Yeah, you might
have to do that.
Anybody duck fishing in the room already? Been duck hunting? Interested in going duck hunting?
I'm going with you, sir.
Well, yeah, whenever you deal up there.
Yep. Hoss, if you put a pair of waders on and you go walking that muck with that hip right now, I'm going to tell you this, they're going to find you in the spring. Because I'm going to leave you there.
I'll be all right.
See you, bud.
All right, see you guys.
See you, bud.
All right, so the second part of tonight is one of my biggest passions in life. I know it's tigers as well. Duck hunting Tampa Bay is it's a tricky thing. There used to be a lot less shoreline to hunt in Tampa. They opened up Pinellas County last season. I don't think anybody knew about it. I don't think there was but like 5 gunshots fired on that side.
Biggest thing is that the reason why is because it's so, unless you know it because it's so new, there's so many areas that are off limits. Like you can't, like Weedon Island, you can't sit there and hunt certain parts of Weedon Island because you're around that power plant.
Up in Tampa Bay Park. Can't hunt up in Tampa Bay Park, but you can hunt all the Double Branch, you can hunt all the Rocky Creek, you can hunt Channel Bay, Dick Creek, Mobley Bay. But once you get up around Upper Tampa Bay Park, you're gonna, yes sir. I found that there's a few key points that I wrote down as far as locations on how to find birds in Tampa Bay. We have a lot of tributaries. We have a lot of inshore lakes and a lot of inshore reservoirs that surround Tampa Bay. If you get on Google Earth, and I know Tiger does it, and I know a lot of duck hunters and I know it too, we spend hours and hours on Google Earth just going over the mangrove lines, looking at the potholes that are inside the mangrove lines, and in doing that, we found awesome redfish and opportunity too. A lot of the shoreline in Upper Tampa Bay, as well as the shoreline down here, has a lot of creeks that you can't access even through a kayak. The water flows through the mangroves. You can see it on Google Earth. It looks like a great creek. You're going to pull up to it in your canoe or your john boat and slide up under the mangroves and get back into the sunny hole. I haven't found that one yet. Every time I find a great looking hole, I'm like, God, I need a damn gas power chainsaw, and I need a weed whacker, and I need a machete, and I need a whole crew from Home Depot to help me out to get in here. But just because you can't get back into those holes doesn't mean you can't kill the birds that are going into them or catch the fish that are coming out of them. We have about 4 or 5 spots that are just north of Gandy where you can't get a boat back into where the fish go, but if you're there on the right outgoing tide, you can just park your ass right in front of it, and pardon the language, you can park right out in front of it and catch all the fish you want to catch. The ducks do the same thing. They're going back in these holes to go feed. Eventually, either the tide's going to come up too high to where they can't get to what they're feeding on, or it's going to be too low or it's going to be mud back there. They're going to come in and out of there on one of those two scenarios. If you spend time on Google Earth and you spend time on the water and you find these transitioning holes and just watch them, I think that being a good duck hunter has a lot to do with how much time you can spend out there and how much time you can observe. We'll spend 2-3 weeks before opening season just going to different reservoirs in the state, spending countless hours on Tampa Bay just watching sunrises, which, I mean, it's great. Everybody likes watching a sunrise come up on the water. Everybody wants to be fishing at the same time. I'll go pick a flat that I love to fish that may or may not have these holes and see if there's birds that are transitioning at first light. I'll be throwing the topwater and just keep my eyes in the sky. Finding those inshore lakes and reservoirs are the biggest key to success on Tampa Bay. If you know anything about ducks, they can't drink salt water. There's very few birds in the world that can drink salt water. I think the skimmers that roost out there, nest out there on Reddington Beach are one of them. Pelicans can only drink so much of it whenever they're eating. But a duck, whether it be a diving duck or be a puddle duck, is going to leave the bay at some point and go get himself a drink of fresh water. Whether it's brackish or fresh, he's going to leave the bay and go inland and try to get something to drink. He may come right back 15, 20 minutes later with his whole flock and go sit right back out in the middle of the bay in a big raft of 1,000 birds. But eventually, that flock is going to all transition into one of these holes. You can find them on the east side of the bay. You can find them on the north end of the bay. I really don't hunt outside of Tampa Bay on the salt a whole lot. I hunt a lot of freshwater inland. We fish and hunt on the east coast around Merritt Island. We also hunt a lot of the lakes north to here up in Sumter and Hernando counties. If you like to bass fish, you can do the same thing we do on the bay. We go duck hunting about 10 o'clock in the morning, pick everything up, and start fishing. As far as public water, knowing where to put in, where it's legal to hunt, is like anything. You can't fish certain areas in the bay. It's pinnacle to know these things whenever you're discharging a firearm. You can get yourself in a world of trouble and a world of hurt if you're in the wrong place at the wrong time. Like I
this
said,
is go ahead. One thing about when you guys are duck hunting, and making sure you fit. So in this area, you know we have all these mangrove islands and everything down here. You cannot legally hunt standing on the island, on ground. Your feet must be wet at all times. At all times.
If your feet aren't wet, you're not in Tampa Bay.
Mm-hmm.
You're on an island.
And yeah, you're on then state property that you cannot hunt from.
Yep.
But you can be in a boat, power pole down, or stake down, and sitting in water, and hunt with the mangroves touching your back. But if you're, let's say it's a very low tide, and there is no water underneath that mangrove, and you're standing on those shells, and there's no water underneath your feet, you'll get a ticket. All you have to do is take that one step. But if you don't take that one step, FWC will give you a ticket in a heartbeat. The other rule is, depending on where you're at, you have to be 500 yards away from a house if you're shooting in a direction of a home. So a lot of you guys know where I duck hunt over here.
Yeah.
You got, yeah, you do, because I'm right behind your house, Hoss. Every day, 6 o'clock in the morning, I'm waking Dave up, calling him up, say, hey, just giving you a heads up, we're starting to blast. It's about to come down. Now, you can have your back to a house, standing in the water with the house to your back. As long as you're standing in the water and you're shooting in this direction, you're good to go.
Yep. How
do
people in the house know you're shooting in the other direction? Like, they're sleeping.
They come running out. Trust me, we've had it all the time. We get people that are across the way over there, they're screaming and yelling at me.
Have people cuss me that they stand up. This happened on an opener at Teal. I actually found some birds in a great fishing spot, and it's a spot that a lot of people know. Well, guess what? Open the morning teal season, my decoys are out. These guys are starting to show up at kayak tournaments. I just stand up. I knew the birds were coming at 9 o'clock. I was like, all right, well, these guys can fish until 9 o'clock, because when 9 o'clock rolls around, the birds are coming in, they're catching hellfire whether they like it or not. Well, sure enough, at 9:15, there's a guy fishing probably 200 or 300 yards away from us on the point, and my buddy goes, here they come. I yell, hey, man, I got birds coming. He goes, what? And then here comes a volley of gunfire. His boat was on plane in about 30 seconds. He was out of there. So yeah, keep your head on a swivel when you're out there for duck hunters, if you're out fishing. You see ducks that aren't moving a whole lot, they're tied to the mangroves. A lot of these birds don't do that in Tampa Bay. They're out in the middle of the bay. Y'all see crap. So stay away from the guy that has a duck that's flapping in one spot. He ain't going anywhere. Stay away from him.
And what's crazy, though, is so it happened to us last year. I was duck hunting with Josh Simmons. Kayakers come right in the middle of our decoys. We're hollering at them, everything. They said, You don't own the water. Well, when we're hunting and you're with a firearm, if you're in our decoys, you're now impeding a hunt. And it is a federal law that you will get a federal ticket for. Now, you can't just go to the courthouse and pay that. You get to go face the big judge for that one. But it's called impeding a hunt. Same way with deer hunters. If a guy's sitting there hiking or whatever, and you're standing there and he won't move, or he's sitting beside, oh, I'm just going to stand here.
Yep.
It's called impeding the hunt. You either move or just call FWC and they'll come moving for you. That simple. But try not to run over our decoys. They're kind of expensive.
They are expensive. I got a good fix for that, too, to tell you all about. talking about watching birds, you'll see out here in Tampa Bay, we'll have a bunch of diving ducks that wrapped up in the wintertime. I mean, thousands of ducks out there. We filmed a raft of redheads and bluebills that got up last year. I'd never seen more birds. I've been to Arkansas, Mississippi, all over the place, kind of like Ty. I traveled everywhere hunting ducks, and I don't know, 5,000-10,000 birds somewhere in there.
What was that this year? Because I think I saw the same raft.
That was... He was hollering at me. It was December.
It was December because I told you they were coming your way.
Yeah.
There's a late December scout I went on looking around and stuff, but I saw like 10,000 bluebills.
Oh,
but
these stupid. And it looks like a cloud moving.
Yeah.
I was like, I've never seen that many in Tampa Bay before.
It's unbelievable. We've got the largest bluebill migration for the wintertime on the Atlantic Flyway right here in Tampa Bay. So y'all are driving across all these bridges. You go across the bay and you'll see rafts of birds out there. You can kill them. Go out there and shoot them with us. It's fun. They fly fast. You get to kill a few of them.
And they're tasty.
And they're good.
They're tasty. God, I love to eat a duck. God, especially the bluebills.
You eat the bluebills out here?
Oh, God, yeah, dude.
You gotta never make them. Dude, never eat
put them things in Coca-Cola the next day. Wrap that bad boy in bacon.
In Coca-Cola?
Coca-Cola.
Yeah, it breaks them down.
Oh, it pulls all that gaminess out of them.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
They make good jerky, too. They make real good jerky. Decoys.
Not to that point. You take me out to catch a red, three or four trout, and kill one of the birds. You clean the birds?
I do everything.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yep, sir. This is the trick, though, I found out. So, if you clean birds before you get home, the only thing you have to have is a piece of the wing with you. In your bag, because the FWC has to be able to identify that bird.
Yep. So I'm gonna hand you a bag full of fillets and a bag full of wing clippings. You have to have it's six birds a person. It's six birds a person.
Aggregate
total. And you've got to play the point system. There's a bunch of different species of birds. We kill about 10 different species of birds out on the bay. You're only allowed so many of each species. That's up to your guide who takes you and tells you, okay, don't kill that one, kill this one, kind of thing. Talking about decoys, y'all saw me lug these decoys in here, and I don't think we have a whole bunch of duck hunters in here other than me and Ty and Tiger, maybe a few other guys have done it before, but what kind of decoy rigs do you have?
Well, mostly I'm hunting tumblers in the Central Florida East Coast, so teal, a couple of legions, some, you know.
Do you have decoy bags or do you do Texas style rigs?
I got both.
Got them both.
Whatever I bought that was cheap on eBay.
I got you. I brought this in just in case anybody wants to take a dive and get into the most cumbersome hunting sport that there is with the most gear and cost the most money and cost the most time and will drive you crazy.
Check
and
get
the
divorce.
big decoy bags. I'm not going to say everything in the past because I have them, he has them, you have them, but Texas will always figure it out. Tangled up here somehow, some way on the water. You unclip this thing and every single bird is tangle free. You've got a weight transition from the top to the bottom of the rig. Allows you to tell them really easy. The weight stays on the decoy and slides up and down. You can stick your finger right here on it and sling them out. When you go to pick them up, all you have to do is put the decoy line, grab a carabiner, and you're picking up decoys a lot quicker than grabbing the old school ankle bait and wrapping around the decoy 100 times and twist around his neck and you go to dump them out and they're all tied together. If you're going to get into it, I think it's like $20 at Bass Pro Shops.
$20 just for the rig-a-rig.
Just for the rig-a-rig.
Just for the rig-a-rig.
Not the decoys.
Not the decoys.
Decoys can be expensive, but I also have a remedy to expensive decoys. If you guys have old bag decoys, this looks bootleg and horrible, but it works.
Old decoys, these are my dad's. These things are probably 25 years old. Buy yourself some spray paint. Touch them up. Turn your greenhead mallards into Florida mallards. If there's greenheads out here, there's a handful. There are local birds that live in ponds that are crossbreeding with our mottled ducks. If you're not familiar with duck species, you see these on Tampa Bay all the time. The male and the female are both brown. They both quack like a mallard. The way to tell them apart, the male has that bright yellow beak. The female's got an orange beak with speckles on it. I turn all these green heads into male mottled ducks or female mottled ducks. You see a guy out there, he's got 150 decoys out, he's got about 50 green heads out there. He's a duck commander, duck hunter. He doesn't know what he's doing. He's the guy that's blowing his duck call as loud as he can, hail calling, everything goes by. Some ducks don't even quack. Don't be that guy. Don't be that guy. You're going to blow birds out. You're going to piss off the guy next to you. Grab your old mallard decoys, touch them up with some paint. Another thing I do too, like I said, we have a ton of bluebills out here. We have the biggest migrating flock of bluebills being painted flyway. I turn old mallard decoys into bluebills. Buy 3 or 4 cans of spray paint, touch them up, toss them out there. I've got bags and bags of my dad's old decoys that I'm turning into bluebills, and they work awesome. I mean, they're not the shape of a bluebill, but from a mile high, when they see them, they cut down on them and they can't help themselves. They sit right in there with them.
And outside of using the Texas rig, because, all right, so as a lot of you guys know, I have literally probably 300 and some people. Because you have to compete. You have to think, when those ducks are wrapped up out there, you're competing with all those wrapped up ducks. Because when those birds are transitioning from some of these freshwater ponds that are over here, or some of the creeks, when they're flying that high, they're looking for those rafts of ducks. So you have to be able to compete with those guys. So I found a way to do it. Yeah, it's a lot of ducks. But there's certain ways that you sit there and you can set your decoys up to be able to compete with them, because it makes them look like it's absolutely, I gotta be there. I gotta be in that spot. The way I rig my decoys, I have 24, 48 decoys that are like that. The rest of my decoys are all on long lines at 24 a shot, where I have a 5-pound weight at one end that's able with a carabine to either the front, or I can go from the back. It all depends, because you have to remember, the tide here is always going. Your tide's always going to move during a duck
hunt. You want your ducks to swing whenever that tide, yep, and that wind's moving.
So when you have them that way, you sit there and you don't use like regular like paracord. There's that, it's almost like leader line.
It's like 400-pound test, I think.
Yeah.
400-pound test.
It doesn't sit there and get tangled up when you do it. So all you're doing is sitting there and just tying one end to another on those bad boys. That way, when you go to pick them up, you pick up that 1 5-pound bait weight, dump it in your bag, and the rest of them just come on in.
Yep.
You just reel them on in. But there's certain ways that we'll go over to sit there and show you guys how to do it. It's not nuclear science.
Yeah, it's, like I said, no greenheads. Don't put greenheads, mm-hmm, in your spread. He talked about putting out 150 cans or Deeks decoys. The bigger the spread, the better. You'll see a lot of duck hunters on the bay. They'll have 2 bags of decoys. They'll pitch them out. They'll throw their little flapper out there. They got a duck on a stick with rotating wings. Those 2 dozen birds aren't going to compete with us 400 yards down the shoreline when those birds are flying 2,000 feet up in the air and they see, oh, there's 12 ducks over there and there's 6 greenheads in there. I didn't look right. And they'll see a raft of 150 birds and they're like, okay. So decoy spread is probably... You can't kill birds unless you're on birds, but if you're on birds, your decoy spread is what is going to kill the birds for you.
Mm-hmm.
I will not hunt on the bay with less than 100 ducks out there. When we go over to Merritt Island, it looks like a clown car. We'll put 4 guys in a 16 or 18 foot jump boat. Every guy's got a bag of 50 decoys in his lap or two. There's palm fronds sticking out of the boat. We're up pretty much waterline on the John boat, and we're plowing all the way to the spot. We get there, and it's an hour and a half of wading through the mud, sweating to death, slapping those seams and mosquitoes, putting out decoys. But that hour after the sun comes up, your gun barrel's hot. And the guy next to you with 40 decoys out that have green heads and the flapper in the middle of them, he ain't shooting.
Nothing.
We do all that for only 6 ducks.
What's that?
You do all that for only 6 ducks.
That's not even about killing them. It's just about staying out there.
It's about the hunt, man. There's something about duck hunting that'll blow your mind.
You think it's crazy. It's absolutely crazy. But I can say the exact same thing. You're going to go out there all day long, all short, for 2 red grouper.
Yeah. Or you're going to go out here on the flats for 4 trout. I mean,
and 1 snook. I mean, so you just got to look at it as, yeah, it's crazy we do a lot of work, but you do a lot of work the same way when we do go
fishing.
You're
doing a lot of work, but you're also sitting in a blind. It's not your typical hunt. We're doing it right now. We're duck hunting in a room. We're sitting here talking. We're laughing. We're having a good time, and that's what goes on in the duck blind. It's not sitting in a deer stand where you have to be quiet. Yes, it's cold, but, I mean, who cares?
Solve all of life's problems in the duck blind.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. Some of the best inventions never invented are in the duck blind.
Just be honest. Y'all do it if you get to wear makeup.
Right, thank you for coming.
Yes, that's why I grow up here, so I have to use less makeup. Yes. That way it keeps the mosquitoes and no-see-ums out of there.
So that you know, Tiger had a sponsor call in last year. I wonder if they could send him makeup.
Right? They're like, now how do you get it off? I'm like,
please don't tell me
it's
a hard case.
It is.
Is it that guy?
It
yeah,
is.
That guy calls everybody.
He called me up and sent me about a case of it, but I'm not gonna lie to you, it's the easiest to take off. I just take a baby wipe.
It's actually really freaking good.
Dude, now they have it like in the eyeliner, you can sit there and just like, no. Dude, it's crazy, I swear to God. You see people sitting there putting all these different designs on their face. I'm like, dude, I just put a dab in my hand, rub my face together, I'm like this.
Stop.
We're done.
Stop.
I'm not lying.
We talked about greenheads not being a good thing to throw into your decoy spread. I hate to say, especially you know the way things are today, but ducks are racist. They do not like each other.
The only ducks that here in the bay that will actually be in the same pod or in the same raft are bluebills and redheads. But still, they may be in the same pod. But it's in a rare canvasback. But it will be the bluebills will be here, and not 5 feet will be the group of redheads.
Or you'll see a string. You'll see 50 birds in a perfectly straight line, and they're all bluebills. And then the four up front are redheads. So lay out your decoys like you see the birds. I don't mix. There's 1, 2, 3, 4 species of ducks right here. I wouldn't cluster all these birds together. I throw, let's say Merritt Island. You have widgeon, gadwall, pintails, Florida mallards, green-winged teal, blue-winged teal, bufflehead, shovelers.
Models.
Young birds.
Mergs.
Gansers.
So when we go to Merritt Island, like I said, we'll have a clown car full of stuff. We have a boat that just, I mean, loaded down, and we'll have guys like, all right, man, you're throwing out the teal, and you go throw out the bluebills, and you go throw out these, and we'll keep them together but separated. And like Tiger said, putting your decoys in certain positions, certain angles, is clutch. It's key. You have to do it. Ducks, like I said, are very particular. I already told you that they won't land with one another. They want to land in a flock of birds that is giving them an opportunity to land, if that makes any sense to you guys. We'll put out 150 decoys. Ducks like landing facing into the wind. If you have a good ripping 15, 20 mile an hour wind, which is an awesome duck hunting day, horrible fishing day, the more wind, the better for me. I put my birds stacked in channels, kind of like these seats are lined up. I'll have, let's say, 4 rows about 4 feet apart, 20 birds long, and then I'll have a gap about as wide as these chairs, and I'll do the same exact thing. I gave them an alley. All these birds are going to be facing in the wind, they're decoyed, or the decoys are going to be facing the wind because of the anchors, are all going to be facing dead into it. You're going to have a gap in between them. The birds should, in theory, circle around this group of decoys that you have out, find that channel, and land in that channel. That channel works as like a gap, like I said. You can also set a hook, just like a fishing hook, same shape. Put a string of birds in a giant hook. Make that hook to where the birds can land facing into the wind. Another, what am I missing here? We got a hook, we got channels, we got pockets. You can also, V's work great too.
V's.
Pockets, let's say this is the area that I want to kill my birds. From that wall, I'm going to throw, I don't know, 15 to 20 birds in a long string. I'm gonna have groups out in front. I'm gonna have groups that close it in. So where you guys' chairs are sitting is gonna be a pocket. Those birds will feel comfortable landing in that pocket. They'll feel safe landing in that pocket because they're surrounded by other ducks. And now all depends upon the wind. How you set up, where the birds wanna go, and how they're gonna land into the wind is key.
The easiest way to show them is do it like this. So let's just say this is the blind. This is about the average, about three duck hunters to stand in, okay? So once I sit there and I get my boat up against the mangroves to figure out where everyone's going to hunt, usually it's going to be someone's going to be here, someone's going to be at the front of the boat, one person sitting in the back of the boat, standing back of the boat. So when you set those decoys up, I want a line to be able to come straight at that person. Because when they see that line of ducks and they see that, I call it the landing zone because it looks like a landing strip. When they see that, for some ungodly reason, they see a line of ducks, they want to fly over top of those bad boys and land right in front of the first duck. Every daggone time. It never fails. So when you set them up, you sit there, you can do the V where you put a weight here, then 24 line up back that way, and you're going to depend on the tide to either shift them that way or this way. But you want basically the weight to be up here close to the middle. And right here in the front, I like having a great big old wide open area. And in that wide open area, I'll take 12 of those rig 'em right ducks and just put them out, just space them out, because that way it still gives them that landing zone, but it's still, those ducks are moving a little bit different than the ducks that are lined up and don't want to fly right into there. So that way when that bird's coming from here, flying all the way across, he'll do that loop around, and when he comes back in, he's going to look for that landing zone, and when he comes to that landing zone will be right in front of a duck hunter. So when they see that duck coming in, you see those wings cup up and their feet sit there and put the brakes on, that duck hunter's got time to put the trigger up and start smoking them. Now, if they hit them, it's up to them. I can lead a horse to water, I can't make him drink. Just saying.
How many ducks do you wait for before you start shooting light? Like 9 months?
It all depends. So usually when it's shooting light, probably even actually 10 minutes before shooting light, you'll see one or two birds start coming. Those are usually what they call a scout. Okay, those birds are going, they're the first two birds that get up out of their raft, and they're going to go try to find those. Now, believe it or not, ducks can smell each other, and they can sit there and recognize each other. So when those two birds get up, everyone knows which direction they're going in, so when the rest of them pop up, they're looking for those two guys to find out where they're at and where they landed. So we let them go ahead and go. You don't want to sit there and kill them. Okay. You let them go, because if they're flying by, that 15,000 pod of ducks, they're going to be flying by.
Anybody, I heard some guys from out from the West, Midwest, anybody hunt crows, never shot crows, get on a crow hunt? Never shot. All right, crows do the same exact thing with the birds you talk about, the ducks. They'll send a scout. And crows, if you watch a flock of crows, they'll talk to one another. They'll send that scout out, he'll land in the tallest tree, and he'll sit there and just squawk and squawk and squawk. I mean, sometimes it'll go on a couple of minutes, sometimes it'll go on 20, 30 minutes. But once he squats up there for a while, you'll see two more come. They'll land the tree next to him. And then two or three, and then a whole flock will come in. So those scout birds the tiger was talking about, if you know that you're in an area where you're just going to rain hellfire down with your shotgun at first light, and you got a group of four coming in, but you know within 5 minutes you got a group of 200 coming in, don't cut loose. Let those four birds come in. Let those four birds work. Let them sit down and just wait. If they're getting ready to leave, cut them. If they land in your decoys and they're flapping around, they're having a good time, and they're happy, stay quiet, just sit there and wait. You got motion in your decoys. That's why I'm holding this ugly-looking thing. Motion in the decoys is huge. This is a trick that we use in Alabama. I went to school at Auburn. We used to hunt a lot of flooded timber to kill mallards, wood ducks, Canadian geese. My buddy, the redneck electrician out of Birmingham, Alabama, showed up at my house with a spool of copper wire and a light here on the floor, running around with it so you can see on the side of this duck. He hooked a switch to it, sitting right by Tiger's foot, and ties it off to his battery posts. Yeah, still mornings a lot of times where there's no movement on the water. You look at a raft of ducks on the water, and there's no wind, there's movement around that raft of ducks. Your decoys are plastic, they don't have a brain, they can't move, they can't think, they can't do anything, they're just going to sit there, dead still on the water, and not make a ripple. Ducks always have some kind of movement unless they're wrapped up and sleeping. Even at that, they'll wake up and they'll paddle as a raft back up tide, and they'll drift back with the tide. So on those still mornings, we'll rig up jerk rigs, attach to Tiger's long strings of ducks. You'll put a piece of cord, whether it's a bungee style cord or a straight piece of cord, just to give those ducks a quick snatch to make that entire raft move. Yeah, but you don't sit there and keep doing it all morning long. You see ducks working, pick up that jerk string, rig two or three, because all the guys in the blind can all have one. Tie it off to your foot, do whatever you have to do. Just give your decoys a little wiggle. Back to my redneck buddy. He bought a bilge pump. He cut a hole in the bottom of a decoy, stuck a bilge pump to it, sealed it off with silicone. Now this one,
Been shot,
so it doesn't work anymore. We'll get to that in a second. It was moving, and my buddy's like, oh, there he goes. I said, no, too late. So all you got to do is rig it up. Now, this one's going to be filled full of great stuff. You know that foam brick sealant? There's a small pellet hole in here. We'll stick it in there, fill it up, and it's going to be bulletproof. You can shoot it if you want to. You can do that with all your decoys if you want to. Go buy a case of great stuff, pop a little bit of hole in it, fill it all the way up. Now you got a foam-filled decoy. It's like the old-school cork decoys that you used to be able to shoot. A buddy of mine showed me that, and it works awesome. He'll seal off a hole with a little dab of Gorilla Glue and sand it down when it's dry, and you're good to go. But this thing killed us many birds in flooded timber where there is no movement. It's just a stagnant pond. And we'd have ducks circling a hole in the middle of this flood of timber. And then same scenario on the bay. You have jerk strings out, you got your this thing painted up like a bluebill, set it out in your spread and turn it on. This is a 400 gallon per hour bilge pump. This is a 1 pound decoy. It scoops this thing to your decoys. It's like a bumper car. If you put it where he's gonna run into a bunch of other decoys and they all start moving, it's awesome. The birds just can't stand it. They just cut sideways and fall right on top of them. And it's cheap, 20 bucks. Some silicone and some wire, and you're good to go. Talked about great stuff, filling your decoys up with them. We talked about rear rights, good versus bad motion. We talked about that. Don't be lazy, move your decoys. If you're having a slow morning, you got 100 decoys out, and the guys a half mile down the shoreline are burning their barrels up, and you're watching these birds work, I'm not saying go crash this party, but go get in the line of flight somehow, some way. Pick up your decoys and move. If the birds are going to one place, it's not like you're going to sit there and look across the flat at a guy catching the trout on every single cast, and you're going to sit there and keep doing the same thing. You got to move, you got to keep moving. Moving decoys is just part of it. Where are we at? We got blind placement. Can you talk about blind placement a little bit with me?
Yeah, it's Tampa Bay can be tricky because you cannot build a fixed structure in Tampa Bay. So we use our boats. And then in some cases, we sit there and we do it, like there's certain spots that Frank and I will hunt. You're gonna find that palm fronds are your best friend. Every morning we go duck hunting, we find a group of palm trees and we're gonna cut them.
Or if you're the first guy awake and you send them a text message saying, hey man, go ahead and cut palms. I hate getting that text message. There's always find some public easement, roadside, the roads in Florida, as a gentleman can tell you, are your roads. And if there's a whole bunch of cabbage palms, you're doing Parks and Rec a favor if you're going to trim them up, because eventually they're going to have to trim them up or pick them up. So I cut up the cabbage palms that are growing up and down 41. There's thousands and thousands of them out here. How many palms is enough?
There is no answer. How many can you fit in the boat?
How many can you fit in the boat with all your stuff and not capsize? How many palms you bring? Somewhere between 30, 40 sometimes.
It all depends. The other trick too is when you guys cut them at an angle. So that way they have a point. Because our trick of it is that we want to take those palm fronds and let the shaft of that palm frond be as long as you want it to be. Because you're going to stick it in that mud or you're going to stick it in that sand, because we've got spots where we'll sit there and all around us, it looks like nothing but a wall of palm fronds. We'll take our seats and just sit down and relax. Or for you on my boat, I have little spots where I can just slide them down in there, because you're just trying to sit there and you want something different. You want to sit there and not be usual, because you stick my boat against the mangroves, it's going to stick out.
Yep.
But you put those palm fronds in there, it's going to completely deaden up everything. They're different colors. We use, I don't know, 30 to 40 palm fronds.
Brazilian pepper trees, they work awesome too. Anybody familiar with what they look like? They're growing everywhere. They're a nuisance. They're, what's the word I'm looking for?
They're invasive.
Invasive, thank you. I was going to say feral, but that would be a hobble.
Or a cat.
Yeah. Yeah, they're invasive, so cut them. They look like mangroves, but they're little red berries. And if those ducks eat those little red berries, they're already close enough for you to be killing them or missing them, one of the two. So you have those huge wintertime tides like we do, big swinging tides, 3.5 foot tides. People are trying to figure out, man, I can't stand on dry ground. How the hell am I going to get to these birds? I'm going to look funny out there in the middle of the flat with bigger palm fronds around me and Brazilian peppers around me. It doesn't matter. I don't know why, but we can be 100 yards out onto a bone dry flat, throw out our rapid decoys, build us a fort out of palm fronds and Brazilian pepper trees, and those birds will still land right in the middle of it. I don't know if it looked like a clump of crap floating across the bay, if the birds just aren't from around here, don't know there's not supposed to be a mangrove there. I don't know what it is, but people are like, man, I ain't gonna be able to kill these birds. They're way out here on the edge of this point, and I can't build your blind out there in the middle of the bay. I saw a guy, and I'm pretty sure you may have saw him last year too. He was off the Gandy Bridge on the north side. There was huge rafts and divers out there. He had a flats boat or a 20-foot boat, but he had one of those tailgater-style like pop-up tents that he put on his boat, and he draped a camouflage knitting blind that you can buy from Army Navy store over the top of it, and he looked like a giant mangrove island float down the middle of the bay. I don't know the guy personally. A friend of mine knows him, and that guy limited out every single time he went out there shooting divers. Now,
shooting divers is shooting divers. It's fun. They're not the best table fare, but you can eat them, soak them with Coca-Cola, and they're good, but it's just fun to get out there and do it. There's more than one way to skin a cat. Build your blind any way you can build it. Put it where it needs to be, and if it doesn't work, change what you're doing.
Well, Mike, you went out with me last year. How easy was it for me to sit there and set it up when we went out there? Done.
Half hour?
At the most. And I was putting everything up because I have one of those great big huge Abram tank camo nets that I'll sit there and drape over the whole boat. I'll take palm fronds and position them there on the boat so that way it just blocks you. It breaks up the human silhouette. And you put it in front of your boat and it just breaks up the boat. You don't have to cover up the whole entire front of the boat, but you sit there and just break it up. Put some, like if you're standing in here on the end of the boat and you've got birds coming this way and you're standing here, stick one or two palm fronds right here in the ground beside you and it just completely breaks it up. It doesn't have to be nuclear science. You don't have to sit there and be completely camoed in. It's just breaking it up and making you look different. It's like the ducks won't even pay attention to you. I mean, how many birds do we have come fly in on us? And you're sitting, look, y'all see how tall he is. He's sitting on the bow of my duck boat in a 2-foot elevated chair, comfy as can be, and birds flying right in front of him. Right in his face. Not even caring where he's there. With makeup on, by the way. Just let everybody know. But it's not nuclear science. A lot of people want to make it harder than it is, make it, you know, way more technical than it should be.
Pea-sized brain.
Yeah.
It's got to be smarter than a pea-sized brain. And we're making it sound easier than it is. You got to get out there, and you've got to be out there for your sunrises. That is the biggest thing. Or sunsets if you're shooting a roost. Tricky part shooting a roost. Ducks don't fly in legal shooting light most of the time when they're roosting. So if you find some birds that are flying before legal or in the legal shooting light, get on them and kill them because you're finding a needle in the haystack. But I think that in order to be successful on Tampa Bay, it's all about man hours on the water, just like fishing, and spending your time at sunrise watching these birds fly. They're going to fly within the first 2 hours of sunlight. Typically, they're flying with the shore birds, all your spoonbills, your seagulls, your herons. Observe their flight paths if you're wanting to kill birds. It's the same thing we talk about transition redfish, where the bait source and bait schools are going to be traveling on a certain line, as same as the fish are going to be traveling on that line. Ducks are creatures of habit. When they find a happy flight plan, they're going to keep maintaining that flight plan. And a lot of times, the shore birds roost what are called rookeries, or bird roost, on the bay. They share them with ducks. So you'll see these shorebirds start flying. Just be ready. Once they start coming to the top of the mangroves, they have some birds mixed in with them. Now, a lot of our ducks here on the bay will fly after the shorebirds too. We'll kill a lot of birds between 8 and 10 o'clock in the morning. Weekends are even better. All you guys are out there burning up the flats, lifting up flocks of birds, getting in those back potholes. People say, man, I hate fishing on the weekends. There's people everywhere. I love duck hunting on the weekends. You scare away the fishermen, and they're lifting up all the birds for you. So it works out great.
And that's why I love the afternoon duck hunt.
Mm-hmm. Everybody's coming back in.
I'm always on the water. What time we go on the water that day, Mike? Because we hunted the afternoon that one. It was like 1 or 2 o'clock, wasn't it?
No.
Because I know come 3 or 4 o'clock. Now, sunset in December and January is not until like 5, between 5:45 beginning December. It's around a little after 6 o'clock. Comes January. But I know between 3 and 4 o'clock, those boats are going to start coming in and they're going to kick all those birds that are all rafted up there just outside of that 6-foot marker. They're on the manatee markers back here and all out there. They're going to kick them up, and as soon as they do, they're coming this way. And as soon as they start flying, I'm like, just get ready. It's like, well, the sun's still up. It don't matter. Those birds are up. I promise you. It, like you said, it's being on the water. It's knowing. I know in the 10 years that I've duck hunted the bay, I know when the wind's coming in a certain direction. The ducks love flying first thing in the morning, but I know where they're going. The guys that fish every day, when they come out, they're going to kick all those birds up, and I know exactly the next spot they're going to. That's where I'm setting up every time. Every time. They're creatures of habit, like you said. It's being on there going, oh, all right, go out with someone that knows what they're doing. I'm not saying going out with me. I'd tell you to go out with Frank. All day long, go out with Frank. Go out with Frank. But we've been out there, we've seen it, we know the birds pattern, we know when they come in, when the wind's gonna be coming out of the north, they love roosting up right here. They'll sit right here the entire time because they're out of the wind. If you guys ever notice, the wind's coming out of the north, it's hardly any movement right here in front of Little Harbor. But if you come here on a Sunday or a Saturday for brunch, you'll see all those ducks sitting right there, all wrapped up together because they're out of the wind. You're not going to see them way out there. And all it takes is a boat to come out of here or come down this channel. It's going to pick all those birds up. They're going to go right on the other side of that island. And as soon as they come up over that hill, they're going to see 300 decoys sitting there, and I'm going to put a bunch of steel.
The only reason Tiger knows that stuff is because he's out there. That was one of the points I was going to bring up is watching the birds. I do the same thing when I'm watching redfish for tournaments. Sometimes we'll go pull up on a school of redfish, and we won't even fish them. It sounds crazy. It sounds boring. But finding out what they want to do, where they want to be, how they react when a boat runs by, where they go when they get bumped. Sometimes we'll watch a school for an hour and a half. They're just happy milling around one little cove. We'll bump them on purpose just to see what they do. We'll just run up on them with a trolling motor and spook them, and then just back right out and see where they go. Sometimes we'll swim in a giant circle. Ducks do the same thing. They're happy in one place on a certain tide, on a certain wind. And if something changes, that tide leaves, that tide comes back in, that wind shifts out of a different direction, they're going to pick up and go someplace else. So finding their happy place is the key to success out here on the bay. Which brings me to hunts on the bay. We kind of do this all together. A buddy of ours was going to be here tonight, but because of the storm, we had to hop in earlier tonight to get out of town. His name is Mike Thompson. I don't know if anybody knows Mike. Mike's been kind of like Ty all over this country. He's actually been all over the world duck hunting. I can't think of a finer shot that I've met. The guy should have probably been an Olympic shooter. He's unfreaking believable, the shotgun. He's a surgeon. And he's killed tens of thousands of birds from Saskatchewan all the way down to Chile. He's one of the guys from the Florida Fowlers. I don't know if anybody in here is on Instagram, but follow the Florida_Fowlers. Got about 7,000 followers. Myself, Tiger, Mike, my sister's fiance is also a captain. He's part of the group. No matter how big your group is, you want to take out three guys, we got plenty of boats. You want to take out 12 guys, we have plenty of boats. We'll line a shoreline, put out 300 decoys, and have a great time. We do hunts for $350 for a two-man group in a boat. Each additional person in that party is $150 a gun. That is for duck hunting only. I do cast and blast, where we can go out and duck hunt till 10 o'clock in the morning, fish till 2. That's $500. I can only take 4 people with my license. I only have a boat that's big enough to bring 4 people. So we can do some duck killing and then do some wade fishing for tail and redfish, sight fishing for trout. We also, my buddy Mike and I both have land up in Alabama and Georgia. Mike was texting me before I got here to make everybody aware that he's got some birds. If anybody wants to go turkey hunting this year up in Georgia, he does weekend trips, has lodging included, feeds you, and puts you on some big gobblers up in Georgia. It's $1,000 for a weekend two-man hunt. We also have, for opening week, if anybody wants to go kill some wood ducks, we've got a hole with about 50 birds in it right now. We're not going to book it until Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday, because we're going to shoot opening weekend in our honey holes on Saturday and Sunday. But you're allowed 3 woodies a person. They're one of the finest eating birds you can kill in the state. And it's a great hunt. It's 30 minutes long. Go into sunrise and rain gun to fire down for 25, 30 minutes. Pick up your birds and go eat breakfast. That hunt's going to be up in Land of Lakes, kind of Brooksville area. So we'll have breakfast after at the Florida Cracker Kitchen. If y'all haven't been there, one of the best breakfasts you can eat after hunting. It's cheap too. And what else can we throw at you?
How much is that?
What's that?
How much was that one?
Which one was that?
The wood duck.
It's $150 a gun. We need 3 people. That's all we can bring in there. It's a 5-man hunt. It's going to be me and him. I'll be picking up birds. Someone can shoot a couple extra birds because I'm going to be holding the camera. So.
And that's usually what we do every time. It's very rare, unless we go together, that we'll actually shoot ducks. Mm-hmm. You can have my limit.
When the man shows up, I kill him, all right?
Always.
But I got some business cards up here. Y'all got any questions for me? I'll pass them out.
What's the equipment that you usually need? Like, say you want to go duck hunting.
For duck hunting?
Yeah.
All right. So, let's start with licenses. As a fishing captain, I can cover up to 4 people fishing. I have all your licenses. I buy a handful of federal duck stamps at the beginning of the year. I keep them. If you're going to duck hunt with me, you have to go on FWC's website and purchase a waterfowl package, depending upon where we're going. You may need a management area stamp, because I hunt a lot of public land. Like I was talking about earlier, on the East Coast over at Merritt Island. We also hunt citrus up here north of us. We hunt some public reservoirs that are up near Crystal River area. And you have to have a management area stamp. You have to have your state duck stamp and your small game license. All of those things sounds like a lot, but all those things are gonna cost you without the federal duck stamp somewhere right around $40, tops. You have to have that. I can't provide that. So I'll provide you your federal, which is $27 over the month. I'll provide you guys with that. If the man comes over and checks us, those are your stamps. If he does not, they are my stamps.
So there's the three that you need before federal?
Yep. Waterfowl permit, migratory bird permit, and your hunting license. And you actually don't even need a big game hunting license. You need a small game, which is cheaper. As far as the rest of the equipment, I can provide you with a shotgun. I can provide you with waders. If you have a larger than size 12 foot, you're on your own. If you're under size 12, wear extra socks. camouflage, makeup. You can bring some makeup if not. Tiger's got some.
Tiger's got plenty of makeup.
Whatever you guys want to eat, I keep ice on the boat. And that's pretty much it.
So you wear camouflage?
It's best to have something that you're going to get wet. You're hunting something that's in the water and you're going to get wet. So, I mean,
honest to God, this is no lie. And Frank's been on there. The only shirt in the beginning of until it gets cold, mm-hmm. like the late Jared, this is the only
dry
shirt that I wear.
Is what I wear.
These
I wear
dry
shorts
pants.
Under my waders.
And I don't wear pants under my waders.
Shorts.
Until
it gets cold.
A pair of board shorts. I wear long socks because the waders will tear up your ankles. One of these shirts, the dry fit shirts, camo ones are fine.
You know the duck hunters at the ramp after the hunt because they are the goofiest looking guys out there. They've got slides on with soccer socks on and mesh shorts and mesh shirts. And if it's cold, then yeah, we'll bundle up.
Those shirts are only $40, see me in it.
Buy one, get one.
It all depends on how comfortable you are. Bring a hat.
Bug spray.
Bug spray.
That's a definite, especially in the early duck hunting.
I keep kind of a small kit, and this thing is not season ready by any means. Let's grab a bunch of stuff. I can provide you guys a shotgun shell, but there's enough places where you can go buy them and not have to pay my fee for shotgun shells. Go to Bass Pro Shops. You have to have steel. If you're bringing your own shotgun, then you know what you need. If you're using my shotguns, I'm going to tell you if you want to buy your own shells, you can buy them. I use 3-inch number 4s or number 2s on the bay. Sometimes 3.5 is late season because the birds are flying a mile high and I want more pellets. I shoot Kents. I shoot Super X, which is a good cheap shell that kills birds. I mean, you shoot Super X at all?
Yeah.
Yep. I think they're like $10 a box. These Kents are $20 a box. Duck hunt's expensive. There's a lot of cumbersome stuff that goes with it. If you're just going to come hunt with us, if you have waders and you have a gun, great. If not, we can supply it. Just wear some earth tone kind of colors or camouflage. Bring a hat, bring sunblock sometimes if it gets hot out there. It's pretty much all you guys need. We're pretty much full service. We have everything you need.
What do you need to keep your duck in muscle?
Talk to that man right behind you.
Two things. Right there.
Good transition.
Yeah.
Going to you.
Cleanse oil, their stuff won't keep your stuff from rusting. But like I use cleanse oil for all the inner parts of my gun and for the barrel, the inside of the barrel. But my gun has a wrap on it.
Right.
And with that wrap on it, I don't have to worry about it ever rusting.
When I have a semi-automatic, should I bring a semi-automatic or?
I love a semi-automatic. I can't stand shooting a pump. It drives me crazy. That hurts my shoulders. But a semi-automatic, 12 gauge. Don't try to shoot a 20 gauge out there in the bay.
It's a 12 gauge.
12 gauge semi-automatic. Make sure you have a plug in it. What I mean by a plug is your gun can only hold 3 shells. That's 1 in the chamber and 2 in the hole.
Right.
Make sense?
Yeah, one just get the plug in. Right now,
if you don't have a plug in that gun and that FWC offer sit there and slides that 4th shell in there, it's a big fine. Big fine.
Make sure you have steel.
Make sure you have, when you go, make sure you only have steel shot in your bag.
Yeah.
And same size?
It all depends on the gun. Your gun will tell you whether or not you can go from, usually it's 2 3/4, 3-inch, 3.5. Some guns only shoot 3-inch, some guns can go all the way up to 3.5.
And if they had 4s, I'd shoot.
Yeah. I shoot 4s too, especially out here in the bay. But you look on the side of your barrel, it'll say 2 3/4 and then a dash, and it'll say either 3.5 or 3-inch, or it just may see 2 3/4.
That's right.
A lot of your older guns, are only 2 3/4, most of them are 2 3/4 inch.
That's a shot size. Don't bring a home defense shotgun.
Yeah, don't. Yeah, make sure it's a. You want at least, at the very minimum, a 26 inch barrel. And a 26 inch barrel is going to be horrible. If you're going to go look to buy a shotgun, get one with a 28 inch barrel, and then
I bought from Ron Sanders.
Oh, then you're good. So, you're good then.
You can go duck hunting.
Yeah, you're
good. Size choke tube do you shoot?
Full usually.
Full.
Yeah.
Extended forward is full.
Just full. I'm not an extended.
Talking about choke tubes in the end of your shotguns, a lot of shotguns have threaded barrels with a buried tip. You can screw in these different chokes to change your pattern. There's several different types of patterns that you could shoot, skeet being super tight. What it does is it changes your shot string inside your shotgun shell. You've got, I can't say if it's hundreds of BBs or what, but a lot of BBs in here. And the pattern that they fly out of your barrel all depends on how your barrel is choked. Shooting a super full choke gives you more knockdown power further down range. I shoot a super full, he shoots a full, what do you shoot?
Extended full.
Pattern Master is a company based out of Arkansas. I met the guy at Mac Wings when I was looking in their case, which is as long as this room with choke tubes inside Mac Currit Wings. If you're not familiar who that is, it's like Cabela's for duck hunters. It's super Walmart or Sam's Club, all that kind of stuff.
It's the Mecca.
It's unbelievable. So yeah, I'm in there looking at these tubes, and oh my God, there's so many different ones. Talking to the guy behind the counter, which one do I use? And this guy that looked like Phil Robertson, but about an extra 100 pounds on him, when he's walking up the beard this long, goes, I have all those tubes and 5 gallon buckets behind my house. I'm like, okay, talk to me. He walks down to the Pattern Master, and I don't know this guy from anybody. He goes, shoot that one. He goes, if you don't like it, come back in here tomorrow. I'll be here about 2 o'clock. He goes, I'll buy it from you. And he's just like, tell me what you think about it. We went out, all of us bought one. There was 3 of us there. We murdered the ducks. We were living it out 15 minutes after we were shooting rice fields in Arkansas. I went back to Max Ferrero Wings to go buy more shells that afternoon. He was there. I about hugged the guy. And I was like, that was the best shooting choke I've ever used. He goes, oh, nice to meet you. He's like, that's my choke. I've been, you know, making it for about 15 years now. I'm trying to get it out there. Now it's the number one selling duck hunting choke tube in the world. So if you're going to get into this and you want to buy a good choke tube, Pattern Master is the way to go. They make a bad to the bone choke.
The way I can explain this like this, in fishing, you have a fishing rod and reel, which averages about $300 to $500. You need about a $500 shotgun really to do this. Your blind bag is just like your tackle bag. In that blind bag, you make sure it's waterproof, because that way they have some that float. Don't get one that floats, because no one ever leaves a blind bag in the water. It's just stupid. If it says it floats, who cares?
Yeah.
They're just trying to charge you another daggone $30 to $40 for a daggone
thing. I will buy a floating shotgun case.
I will buy a floating shotgun case, though. Make sure your shotgun case is floatable and is waterproof. That is one thing that is important. Because you get one, get water in it, you're done. You're toast. But it's in there, you keep everything. You put your shotgun shells, a spot there for your license. You put your lanyard where your flashlights, your snacks, your makeup. Yes, I put my makeup, my compact in there. Your little compacts in there.
Toilet paper
and baby wipes.
Bring them.
Absolutely. It's a must. I can guarantee that.
You're going to be up at 4 o'clock in the morning drinking coffee.
And they talk about women.
I know, right?
Yes, yes, sir.
One of the comments I want to make about chokes, are you guys getting back to that? Make sure when you're putting your choke in your gun that it says it's rated for steel shot.
Absolutely.
Yes.
There's a lot of chokes out there that are going to say right on them, not for steel shot.
Yep. And you will have that choke tube in your barrel for the life of that barrel if you don't listen to
it. If you don't have the old cartoon barrel where it just mushrooms out on you.
Yep, it will weld it or will blow it up.
But it's just like any other hobby, guys. You're probably, to get into it full blast, not including the duck boat, and
that's where it gets expensive.
That's where it gets real expensive. But with your dozen decoys, it's going to cost you about $60. That's not even without the rigums on them. So you add the rigums on, it's another $20, however you want to rig them, but that's just for a dozen decoys. And again, if you only go out there with 2 dozen decoys, you're not doing anything.
Find a buddy that's got a bunch of them.
We'll get a lot of them.
But it's you go in stages. I tell everybody, go in stages. You don't have to go into it full blast. For some reason, my mom and dad put something, if you don't do something right first time, don't do it at all. When I went into it, I went full blast into it. For some reason, every year, I'll get those guys, I'll sit there and try to put 1,000 daggone holes in my decoys. They're easy to patch, but still you're like, it's time for more decoys. Mm-hmm. Never have enough decoys. So it's a great sport. It's a lot of camaraderie. I mean, how much fun did we have, Mike?
We had a lot of fun.
And we had
$150, like the wood duck hunt, that's cheap for the fun you're going
to
have.
Absolutely. I say this to a lot of people, ask me why I do it, why I get up early, why I get wet. Foul weather to us is awesome weather. We mm-hmm. went 15, 20 mile an hour winds, 40 degrees outside, it's raining a little bit. That's awesome duck hunting weather. There ain't nothing else better to do on those days, go out there and burn up a gun barrel. You're going to go shoot two boxes of shotgun shells an hour and a half and laugh the whole time at your buddy who can't hit anything right next to you. So it's a good time.
Yeah.
I remember laughing at that guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, once in a while. It is absolutely. Thank God it's only 2 months out of the year.
I know.
Thank God, because if it was 12 months out of the year.
Couldn't afford it.
No.
Couldn't afford it. It's a good thing tarpon come in.
Yeah, and then redfish, thank God. It's just a good time. It's something that breaks up the monotony of stuff. I mean, it's a Saturday and Sunday in you guys' case during December and January when you really don't want to be home anyway, and it's nasty weather.
Go out, have fun.
And try it. I mean, biggest thing is, the worst case scenario is you go out there and try it, you get to shoot the gun a couple times, you laugh at each other, you got some video to sit there and go along with it. Maybe you shoot a duck, maybe you don't, but I guarantee you one thing, when you see that first flock of ducks come in and your heart starts pounding and all of a sudden you go from being dead cold to sweating hot because you see those ducks, that's when the bug bites you.
Yep.
Big time.
I think everybody is a duck hunter. They just don't know it yet. Once you go and you see what it's all about, you're like, I'm going to spend some money. I'm going to find some decoys. I'm going to find a buddy with a jumbo that we could turn into something. It'll bite you when it does. It bit me at 10 years old. I'm going to be 34 in November, and I've been hard after it. It's any time my dad could take me, and once I started driving, it was fishing and hunting, and that was it.
And the only other thing I could sit there and add is, if you guys have never hunted before, go take a hunter safety course. Seriously, you can take them online, but take one, because it's extremely important. You need to know where that barrel is at all times, whether or not that safety's on that gun at all times, because we're going to sit there, and let's say it's slow. We've only shot like four or five ducks, and there's four of us. And it's slow. We see birds flying high, and they're passing us. Frank and I are going to go out there, and we're going to start moving decoys around everything. I need to be confident that you're sitting in that boat with that gun on safety, down by your side, with the barrel pointing in the opposite direction of me, in the opposite direction of your buddy, and I don't have to worry about it. Because it's not one of those things where you can go out there and have a couple beers and sit there and throw a fishing line. There's no drinking on these hunts. At all. You drink afterwards. It is all about safety.
You can pop one around 11 o'clock. That's fine, but before then, sorry.
It is all about safety, but it's so much fun doing it, though. You're going to have there's been questionable times where I've had buddies out there and I'm moving decoys and I got birds literally flying right above my head and I'll just sit there and drop down and go, just don't hit me. Just don't hit me. Shoot, just don't hit me. Aim above my head. So the only reason why I say that is, some of you guys have heard the story before. I shot my best friend duck hunting one time.
I did too.
We were standing.
He moved. I didn't know it.
We were standing in a duck impoundment. I told him, now Bert ain't but that tall. Bert is literally that tall. I said, look, don't stand directly across from that pond from me because I can't see you. You get camoed in over there. I can't see you. First light comes, first two set of wood ducks come in, I get here, and as I'm going here, I hear don't as I start pulling the trigger. He starts squealing like a stuck pig. I was so scared, I dropped the gun in the water, went out of the pond, ran all the way around to him. He's got his back to me. He had a down jacket on. All I see is duck feathers everywhere. All over the place around him. I'm like, Lord, he's laid wide open. Something's wrong. I'm about to see guts hanging, something. He turns around and he goes, you shot me. And I'm like, I get that. When he turns around, I said, where did I get you, Bert? And he lifts up, his jacket is just gone. But the only thing that got him, one little pellet hit him in the wrist. Didn't even break the skin. But it's enough to scare you. Go, now I don't even play. Gun's always on safety until that duck gets there to you go, all right, Bert's coming in. Then the gun comes off safe. But it's you don't realize how important it is until it that quick it can happen. But it's still a lot of fun.
It's still fun. I shot my buddy too. Same thing wood duck hunt.
Mm-hmm.
They were all dumping in one side of the pond. It was getting dark. He slid around to that side of the pond. We all knew where everybody was at. I killed a bird, started swimming, and I'm going between cypress trees trying to get a shot on him. I go to shoot. Lucky for him, to hit the water, skipped up, hit him in the waders. And I just hear him go, "You shot me." Who is that? I had no idea he was even behind me. He walked through the swamp all the way around to get to the other side where there was nobody. So when we put you out, even if we, let's say, stagger a corner, we're going around an island, stay where we put you. Just don't move. Stay where you're at. Anything bad can happen out there. And we want to prevent me having to do my other job when we're doing this one. I don't want to be a paramedic when we get in there.
Yep. You guys got any questions? Any other questions about getting started? Because getting started is the easy part. It really is. If you guys want to go out, just try it. You got everything you need. I mean, if you just say, "Hey, I don't have a camouflage shirt, or I don't have it," I got tons of them. I got some of them that's not even funny.
Yep, we can take care of it. Whatever y'all want, we got it covered.
But doing the cast and blast is the most fun. It's the biggest bang for your buck. Frank will sit there and put you on.
500 for four people.
500 for up to four people. Yeah, I can't do any more than four people. So that'll be from 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning until 1 o'clock in the afternoon. We'll duck until about 10.
Kids, what's the suggested age?
Well, I mean, it just depends on the kid.
Depends on your comfort level. Depends on your comfort level.
But they won't be shooting. They just want to go.
Well, they can. All ages, doesn't matter to me.
Yeah.
As long as you bring a life jacket for them, because I don't have them for little tiny guys.
Right.
I started duck hunting, like I said. I was toting a shotgun at 10 years old. I started hunting. I was in the woods with my father when I could.